actually, Balochistan is geopolitically very important. It is an area which is very, very important, and it has always been the center of international powers to influence the area. So I think that's the fundamental reason why Pakistan still exists, because there's no reason for Pakistan to exist. It's not a country, natural country, not a nation, but it consists of different ethnic groups, with Punjabi being the dominant group in Pakistan. So everything is decided by Punjab province, while the other provinces, Baloch being the least developed province, is what they call, I mean, they call it a province, we call it our country, but that's the most, the poorest area in Pakistan. So I think international powers have always played a role in keeping Pakistan alive. Still, it's important, because now China, Russia, Saudi Arabia, and different other powers are racing to set foot in Balochistan, especially Qatar, with a CPEC being built there. So the situation is quite complex there, but this is going to be even more dangerous for Baloch people, because these bad guys are trying to come and set military garrisons there. And China already built, it is reported, and if it hasn't, and it is probably going to build a military base in Wellbeing, Balochistan, which will disrupt the international trade route, which will undermine the human rights of ethnic groups such as Baloch people. So I think the situation is quite dangerous in the region, and it's very important for the Western world to take interest and to take notice of these developments in that region. Because if these powers succeed to come in Balochistan with the help of Pakistan, with Pakistan's strategic Islamic jihadi assets, and with the agendas of these international powers like Russia and the China, the entire region is going to be destabilized. So it's important for the international powers and the Western democracies to take interest. And it is important that they support Baloch people, so the international order is not disrupted. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, yeah, it's, I mean, it's definitely more than just Pakistan and India involved. Can you, Suzanna, maybe tell us a bit more of all these actors and what are their interests in this region?
I saw your look on your face and I thought, yeah, that was me, and I
just was
you. Pakistan, and I heard China, India, America, Afghanistan,
yeah.
And I thought, wow, you are very well ahead in conspiracy theories, I thought. Maybe these are, that's what they're called in the rest of Pakistan. But I think something which you might not know, I don't know, but you mentioned CPEC, and I think CPEC stands for China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. So China right now has to go all the way around Asia to get their goods to Europe, for instance. And if they go through, because China is neighbor of Pakistan, China is here, here's Pakistan, here's the sea, if they can make a route through Pakistan, through that water port, which is in Balochistan, they can move their goods much faster and cheaper. So besides all these resources that Balochistan has, that Pakistan wants, now is this added advantage of this quadra port in Balochistan, which China wants to use. China invests a lot of money in this route, and Pakistan simply doesn't want anyone to oppose that, because it's, what you should also understand is the army is very much involved in this project. And I think most countries have an army, they say. In Pakistan, the army has a country. So the army is not just there to protect the citizens, or supposedly so, but it also has a huge conglomerate of companies, building companies, flower companies, banks, all sorts of things. And these are assets they want to protect. And China, the business with China, is also such a business model where the army has an interest. So the issue in Balochistan has complicated a lot. And I think that you can see also in the human rights abuses. The interests have gone up, and the human rights abuses have also gone up.
Yeah, especially since the embrace of the political power of China in the last years.
Yeah.
There's probably a connection between the two.
Sure, yeah. But no trouble is allowed, you can say. Everybody should be on board with this project.
Okay. Taj, do you think that also Europe has an interest in keeping this status quo?
I guess so, because the Europe maybe think it will be worse if I will break one status quo or replace it or dismember it and let some new stakeholders rise up in their places. So the way West is behaving till now, it looks like they're happy. There are some parties of conflict which are hidden so far. We could see them when we see the situation. All the West is ignoring the Balochistan conflict, whatever is going on there. Everybody knows what is going on. Every diplomats know. Every immigrants organization, international mechanisms know what is going on. They say we cannot get through Balochistan and we cannot see the exact picture. But an area of more than 300,000 kilometers is in a huge armed conflict. A state is having his equipment from the West or from other countries. From where the other parties are bringing this much arms and ammunition? Who are behind all this? Who is behind the war business which is going on from Afghanistan? It's touching in Balochistan, and if it connects Balochistan with the Iran, it's just having a half of the world for as a safe haven for war business. Whoever wants to invest can invest this. So there are many portions going on, and I guess West knows what is going on. But it cannot be in the Western interest to break a country and deal with 12 nations. So they feel easier to feed one army and deal with the land of 12 nations, even the indigenous people will die. So it's easier for them to communicate and control the land.
Yeah, around this topic, you previously raised the issue of visibility. and we also, someone also said that there are conflicts everywhere. So this might, this conflict might be a bit forgotten because of this. So I was wondering, do you think that all this interest that come together play a role in the reason why the intelligence can get away with these murders so easily? If we want to say it, they can make it hidden much more than other conflicts that are happening right now in the world. Or do you think there are other reasons for why this conflict is so carefully hidden?
I think they know what they're doing. When I see the developments in Balochistan, in 2001 it started to get worse. At the same time, enforced disappearances, human rights violations started, and the religious extremism started at the same point. 2005, military operations started, and the killing of Shia minority was increased. And in 2009, kill and dump of the abducted people started by military, and the Hazara Shia were killed in hundreds in one day. So things are going parallel till today. And I think there is an agreement, some sort of, to keep it as much hidden as possible. When the UN envoy was kidnapped in Balochistan in 2009, military was already having hundreds of political workers and leaders in their custody, whom they picked up and abducted. In February 2009, the Baloch militants released John Solecki. At the same month, a state started killing and dumping hundreds per year. I don't think West doesn't know it. West knows it very well. Even UN condemned the killing of Ghulam Ahmad. UN ordered an inquiry on Ghulam Ahmad. Nothing happened. UN knows it didn't happen. And they're still keeping quiet. I think that keeping quiet is the best way to say that go on, we are not seeing it.
But there are more ways to raise a voice than governments and
just can I comment on this, because I've written some notes before coming here, and it's I mean, you can say, you can talk about to what extent somebody should do something and to what extent something is visible, but UN has repeatedly asked the government to ratify that international convention for the protection of all persons from enforced disappearance, for instance. The UN had sent this working group to Balochistan, where obviously it needs the cooperation of the government. It needs the UN asked a government to invite them, and the government has to ask, gives that invitation. The UN cannot just barge on somebody's door and step in, because it's obviously the combined nations then stepping on your doorstep. So there are attempts, but it's just really difficult in Pakistan, considering the army having this hold, and also for the government, it doesn't have a full play in what it wants to do. They don't have the weapons, they don't have the say, it's the army that decides what's happening. And that's, I think, why also there is this lack of access. And what did I want to say? I might come back to this, because there was some other important thing. But I'll come to it. It was just in my mind.
Okay, we'll come back to it later. So for meanwhile, you talked about access. But there is someone who
I remember, sorry.
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, because you mentioned about like it's hidden on purpose. If I think of the diplomats that I met in Islamabad, you know, when people come to Islamabad, some of the diplomats, it depends from which country they are, they would ask me, is it safe to go to F7 Markets? That's a main market in Islamabad where everybody goes. But people are being told that there can be attacks here or there. Another diplomat told me upon coming to Pakistan, she said, you know, I'm surprised that women's rights, you know, that there's really discussion about it, it's really going in the right way, it's really developing. I said, which newspaper did you read? She was reading English newspapers, and English newspapers generally have more liberty to speak about issues like Balochistan. So, an editor at an English newspaper will get less threatening calls when speaking about Balochistan than an Urdu newspaper, because English is just simply not spoken by most of the people in Pakistan. So, and these calls, where do they come from? From intelligence, from army. And it's very difficult sitting here understanding that simply a call with the advice not to talk on something is taken as a threat. But that is taken as a threat because people have seen what is happening to journalists who went a step too far. They were either killed or they were attacked by unknown people. But there's only one power in Pakistan that has the intelligence, the capacity to attack on such a large scale. So this is also important, that the understanding of Balochistan, it's so far away, people don't go there. It's there's so many other issues the diplomats are tasked with. You know, the frontier, the Afghanistan. So it's sort of a it's, I would say it's almost non-issue, considered a non-issue between militants and the government, and there's not much understanding also. I believe that also sometimes not even willingly, but just simply so many other things, and it's another indigenous fight, and that's very sorry state of affairs considering what's happening there.
So what you're saying is basically that there's not actually so many interests involved, but on the contrary, there's not enough interest from the international community.
I think so, yeah. It seems it's also pretty deadlocked, like you would also, people would also want to sort of get ahead in it. They don't see it on the Pakistani TV. Pakistanis don't talk about it also. It's in Pakistan, it's also a non-issue. And again, it's very hard to understand sitting here, but there's a huge machinery there. You know, the state narrative is very strong, and everything that falls outside is almost invisible. Yeah.
Well, we will for sure come back later to the question of what can we do then. Should we just leave it like this? But for now, I have the feeling that we as countries or we as individuals, take it however you want, still have a responsibility to somehow raise this issue, and you also talked about it during your presentation towards the end. So what do you think countries or other stakeholders outside of Pakistan and outside of Balochistan should or could do to raise visibility about this conflict?
Well, first of all, they should understand the nature of Pakistan, basically, because I'm going to be blunt about this. The world knows that what Pakistan has been doing after the Cold War in that particular region. I mean, the dilemma is most of the international powers go after some sort of religious groups, they come in the scene, like the ISIS. It is just part of the international Islamic, you can say, system. And Pakistan is the epicenter of Islamic radicalism. And that's the problem. And that's why the international powers are, fascinated by these Islamic movements going on in Iraq and Syria and other parts of the world. And that's why they think these are more important things than the issues like Balochistan and other places. But there's a problem. And that's true that Pakistan is trying its best to hide Balochistan so that the good people of the world would not know. Because as I said in my presentation, in 2013, when a 7.8 magnitude earthquake struck Awaram area, the Doctors Without Borders tried to help in their region, and Pakistan denied it. And we know that Pakistan is not self-sufficient to take care of these calamities created by this earthquake. Pakistan denied because the Pakistani establishment didn't want the international community to come and see, observe, and do their independent research in that area. So it has a sophisticated strategy in Balochistan. No media is allowed to go there. No NGOs is allowed to independently work in that area. In 2015, Pakistan issued Shoka's notices to different NGOs, and they eventually decided to close all these NGOs working in Balochistan, because they think that these NGOs and small groups are basically being funded or being used as spies by CIA or Mossad. This is what they think. So that's why they do not allow them to see and observe Balochistan. And secondly, as Taj said in his presentation, that when Pakistan started countering Baloch nationalists in 2001, they started it by stage by stage. First they killed intellectuals, then they killed journalists, and then they started killing and dumping the bodies of political activists. This is how it is being done in a sophisticated way. I think the world has to realize they have to know the main cause. You know, the problem is not some Islamic groups. You pursue, you kill them, and another group pops up like Mushroom. So I think they have to realize that Pakistan, with some other countries, is the problem, is the cancer. Because all you're doing, all the West is doing, is just trying to treat the symptomatic problems. But the real issue, the real disease, is still existing there, still being supported, and it is trying to tell the world that they are in problem and they are good people, but that's not true. Pakistan is the main cause. Everyone has to realize that and step forward and to stop. First of all, they have to pressurize Pakistan so it stops killing Baloch, innocent Baloch people and other minorities in Pakistan.
Yeah, I would like to point that when you talk about Pakistan, I mean, we said before that Pakistan itself doesn't exist because it's a, you know, it's a mix of different regions with very different ethnicities, so it's more like the heads of state that are building this wall to keep all the international media and all the international aid outside. So far we seem to recognize two main reasons for this lack of visibility, which is on the one side this wall that is being built by the Pakistani intelligence, the politicians that are interested in, of course, not letting people know, and on the other side, like Suzanna was saying, the fact that there's not enough interest from outside to get involved in this issue. But I mean, there are still a lot of people fighting for this conflict, nonetheless. So you talked about extremism. I read somewhere that there are also the Taliban fighting for this cause. Can you tell us a bit more about extremism in general? Why so many keep, in this specific context, so many keep fighting?
I think the existence of Taliban, if you see the map, it's towards the Balochistan's portion, which is connected to KPK, the Pakhtunkhwa or Afghanistan, which is the Pashtun speaking region mainly. And religious extremism to the people of Balochistan is not quite an old idea. I grown up in a Muslim house. I didn't fast, I didn't pray, it was not a matter at all. My parents prayed five times a day, I did nothing. So it was my own choice, you're free, whatever you want to do. It came gradually later. But what I can see, like, there is some incidents where Pakistan military and the Islamic groups, which is locally called Daesh, ISIS, they had some combined operations in Balochistan, where some secular nationalist students were killed in both sides of the firing. On one side, Islamic militants blocked the way, started firing on the students. They tried to run away on the other side, and military blocked the way. And they were killed in the middle, and then everybody took. So there are some evidence which we could see in Balochistan. But I guess putting Islamism in a region is like some long-term investment. It goes for generations, the business goes on. It's not the Muslim or Christian, it's just business. So So it's necessary to put a business because this conflict is not going to be resolved. Nobody is looking at that. It's mountainous area, it's hard area. So it's connected to Afghanistan, it's connected to Iran on the other hand. So it's easy to extend or expand the Talibanization from one place to another. And in result, it gives 370,000 extra kilometers to a business which is already going on internationally. So just an addition in the business for long-term war, I guess, the Talibanization.
Adding to that, because the groups that you mentioned on your, I think it was on your slide, or no, was it, no, it was on your slide.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I think you had Falan Samyat and all these organizations. I followed these groups as well, and I went with them when they aided people in need. And what they do, for instance, before they give food to the people, people have to wait in line. And before they can actually open their food, they would give you some Islamic principles, what are Islamic principles in their eye. So they say, with what hand do you eat? So you will see maybe some head of the family, big man, but he's sitting on the floor and has to hold up his hand, like you eat with this hand and not with this hand. And it's very belittling. And at the same time, these people have no other choice because nobody else is coming to help them. And it's exactly that part where the NGOs are sort of pushed out of the country rather than only Balochistan. It's just also alienating people, and the whole idea of sort of Islamicizing the nation is to sort of keep the country together, because it's right what you say, that everywhere in the country there are people who want to sort of break away, break free, and it's no coincidence, because everywhere in Pakistan people are being held back. I had the privilege, I have to say, because for me to understand the journalism, it's a privilege to speak to Taliban fighters. And it's sometimes very difficult to get through that that rhetoric, like Islam is great and it's for God and blah blah. And one time I was again in such an interview, and this was a young fighter, and it was just hopeless, and I thought, okay, so what do you do, like, for fun? What are your hobbies? And his hobby was playing volleyball, which is a big sport in some region in Pakistan. And then he started telling me about that the leaders of that Taliban group that he was with came to visit once. They played volleyball with them, and they ate with them, and he mentioned that, like, that would not happen anywhere, because the leaders, political leaders in Pakistan, for them, he is nothing. He was just, you know, a poor man, and I'm sure that this is part of the reasons, this lack of respect that people get in terms of education, health, but also just not being seen by their leaders, is one of the reasons why there's so much fighting, because it's really, it's elsewhere, of course, as you rightfully put forward, also, yeah.
And they made it acceptable for the public inside Pakistan that Islam is the only way.
Yeah.
And Islam is in danger, we have to protect it. It's generalized inside Pakistan, even to the level that the public will not question why you are allied with China, who doesn't believe in God.
Yeah, yeah.
Where they want to block it, they will be blocked. Where they want to open it, it will open.
Yeah. Can I ask a question? Yeah, so, I mean, I know a lot, but I also don't know a lot. And I was thinking, like, this army of Pakistan, with its benefits and its money and the weapons, it's not going to go anywhere soon. It's not going to be stopped in its tracks so easily. I was just wondering, like, Pakistan is ruled by this big province, Punjab. Most people live there. And there's some voices in the south of that province that want their own province. And I thought it was very good, because then you break it up. And then leaders have to be sort of more adherent to the wishes of those other groups. Do you guys think that it would help to break up that biggest province of Pakistan, so there you don't have this big power center that can rule the rest of the
world? Once this idea was discussed with the man, Akbar Khan Rukti, 80 years old, who was not killed, and he was in the dialogues, he presented the idea to get Pakistan together every unit like Balochistan, Punjab, and other provinces shall have equal partnership, equal representation in the central government and central assemblies.
And this will be including Balochistan?
Yeah. He agreed to be inside Pakistan with these changes, some basic changes. I think that when Pakistan military is ruling a vast area, which includes four provinces with their complete shapes, if you break them in 20, it will remain the same because the attitude of the ruler is same. So it will not help at all. Nothing.
No, it doesn't help, as you said before.
Respecting the rights, respecting the democracy, be it independent Balochistan or within Pakistan, I don't have any problem personally as a human rights activist, but there shall be respect for human rights.
But the army is never going to give up Balochistan. It's way too important. So I'm thinking, like, what are other ways, sort of backdoor ways to get where you want to end up? Like this.
Sorry to cut you. I think.
It's okay.
Well, actually, you know, nothing like this will change, bring about any change in Pakistan. As you said, Pakistan is not a country, but it's rather armies. Property, like they use Pakistan, as their property, because they, when they retire, they take a lot of
land,
and they are doing all the businesses. Pakistan's like an enterprise for them.
Yeah.
So anything, if you see in the context of democracy, if you think you can make some provinces or you can politically make some territorial changes, I think that won't help. However, if you, and now we see that the Pashtuns have come out, and they are bravely talking about the human rights in Pakistan. It was not expected from us. We didn't think that they are going to do this. Mm. But, I mean, magically they did it.
Does everybody know what happened there? Or should we explain maybe to the audience a little bit?
I think we should explain about it. So we can do anything in order to strengthen our power. Like, we can collaborate with Pashtuns, and we have a common problem, because our people are being abducted and killed the same way the Pashtuns are being abducted and killed. Mm-hmm. Some of the Islamic groups who consisted of Pashtun people went rogue. So they took up arms against Pakistan, and Pakistan in retaliation started treating them like Baloch. So they also have a common problem, and they also have some political views about their nations, like Pashtuns.
So, if I can just say a little bit about this movement,
please.
For those who don't know, there's a man, Mansour Pashtin, he's a local activist, and he rose to prominence after protesting the killing of an aspiring model in Karachi, also from his ethnicity. And he was killed because law enforcement said he was a terrorist, but he was an aspiring model. He had nothing to do with terrorism. And so he started making fame because he can speak very eloquently, and he has large numbers of people showing up to his rallies. And he's speaking about army abuses, which are also happening outside of Balochistan. And this is what my colleague mentioned. It's very unusual that somebody does that, and so openly and so fiercely, and of course his rallies are not covered, because again, media companies, it's a security threat, blah blah blah. But this guy is still attracting a lot of attention, also social media and in real time. And so you were thinking that there should be collaboration.
I think
in some
natural
way,
there should be a
Natural thing,
A natural thing, because not only Pashtun and Baloch have problems with Pakistan, but there are other minority groups like Christians, Hazaras, Shias, and other ethnic groups who are not happy being part of Pakistan. So these people, they consist of most of Pakistan, I think. If with the help of international organizations. I mean, this event today is very crucial. And we have seen in the past the Amnesty International issued urgent appeal, urgent notices for those people who were relatively safer than the other abductees back in Pakistan. Because my cousin was in custody of intelligence agencies, he was held in Kuli camp. When he was released, he told their story that the day when the Amnesty International issued an urgent appeal for his release, an army officer came and asked him about, do you have any links with Amnesty International? Did you, have you ever worked with Amnesty International? This means that any report or any step taken by the Amnesty International plays a role and it plays some pressure on Pakistan. So this is, event is good. And there should be more events, there should be more awarenesses. And with the help of international organization and us being united with Pashtuns and other ethnic minorities, I think we can bring about a change. I'm very optimistic about this prospect.
It's good to hear that.
Yeah.
You're more optimistic than our colleague about the possibility of resolution.
No, I'm too much optimistic on the human rights organization side. But they are blocked with the diplomatic obligations. The countries cannot push Pakistan to allow amnesty inside Pakistan, inside Pakistan. I'm just worried about these hurdles, how organizations can be taken. Because when there was an earthquake and Pakistani government stopped Doctors Without Borders with all its aids and rehabilitation goods in their wagons and ambulances, and they were stopped just on the border of Pakistan and were told to go back, otherwise you will get killed.
Mm-hmm.
So everything went back.
Which
Doctors Without Borders in 2013.
Yeah.
So nobody dared to go and nobody dared to ask in the Security Council and in any international forum that why you are doing this.
Yeah.
So when this point come, everything was going back. Like, all the reports help. I have read, we have too many reports.
But what do you think about this, that this wasn't raised? Because this is such a serious issue.
Even
like
there is more serious issues, like Pakistan army inside Balochistan is getting trainings from Western countries and the counterinsurgency programs. UK is involved, Australia, every country is involved in their military's training how to use different tactics when you capture a person to whom you have a doubt that he is one of the extremists.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, and the other military equipments, like it's going from the West. Military is having contracts, every country has business of the arms and ammunition without any question.
Yeah.
Even all these evidences, Human Rights Watch, Amnesty, everybody reported.
Yeah.
But still, it's not affecting the military equipment contracts.
So in that sense, you're saying that they know, but they don't
do
anything about
it. That's why I say international community knows, but
just
want to close there. Until I'm too much hopeful from the student groups, frankly saying. Because these are the people which are not polluted with the politics and anything. Like some independent journalists who can work on their on themselves. They can follow their own dreams. Oh, that's humanity. I will do my best to do it. Like most of the organizations, international organizations, have stopped somewhere, didn't go further.
Mm-hmm.
Which,
which is what we're doing.
You mean in terms of media organizations, or you say they have a stop, most organizations have a stop somewhere, like they don't go any further?
Yeah. Like humanitarian aid didn't go further inside Pakistan. Media outlets are not allowed to go in Pakistan. Even they are not making an attempt to make their own reports, even through phones, through Skype, whatever. Human rights organization could use some of local resources, which we have many connections. We are collecting data from Pakistan. Amnesty could use them. Human rights watch could use some kind of contacts to get.
And I think your right was like in this time and age, you could not express yourself, you could not go into Balochistan and do your independent research.
Yeah.
Because Pakistan, it was not only you, but Pakistani establishment and Pakistan security forces back in 2007, I think Willem Marx, my brother was his interpreter, they went deep into the border area of Iran. So they interviewed people, they interviewed the family members of the missing persons. When he was coming back from Tomp in 2007, my brother called me and they said they were stopped at a checkpoint by the ISI personnel.
Mm-hmm.
And they even tried to abduct Mr. Wilt Marks. Because they don't want anyone. In this time and age, I think the international organizations and international journalists are even not allowed, and they are threatened directly by the Pakistani.
Yeah.
And same happened with Carlota Gal, I think.
She was attacked in her hotel room. But I also want to say that, like, people who, journalists who come to Pakistan, who don't live there, they are allowed in only three cities, Lahore, Islamabad, and Karachi.
Yeah.
For every other trip, they need to ask permission,
then
and it's very difficult. You have to sit for hours of tea, talk, call, and I mean, and then still, maybe at the last minute, somebody tells you, okay, you can go, or the day after you've made all your appointments, and then still you're lucky. So it is.
So I mean, we understood that even if you're a powerful organization that has international connections and everything, or if you're a journalist, either, especially if you're linked with some media, it can be really hard to actually talk about this this conflict. So I have a last question for you before we go to the Q&A. Do you think maybe individuals, like people less involved, like people like us who today came to the to hear you, could actually do more to solve it? Do you think we have a power more than asking international organizations to raise the voice?
Asking me?
All of you.
Sure. I have faith in that. These are the people who can raise some questions to the conflicts which won't fit the international interests anywhere, but they can take it as a human crisis. The people who are dying are not assets but human beings. The pregnant women who are dying in the mountains because of lack of food and lack of medical assistance, it's a human being, not an entity to be added in a checklist that, okay, we have two wounded bodies, and we have three wounded bodies, so we have to attack from their side. They can take it as a human crisis. And if they do something, like we can request Amnesty to our upper offices, to our regional offices, to our headquarters, to look more closely, whatever we can help them to find out what's going on, in Balochistan, we can collectively do our best to provide more information to the any human rights organization which can do something, which can hear something. I think we are the people who can do something rather than to expect from someone else that I have to go to convince the U.S. ambassador that he or she shall take an initiative. It's better to convince ourselves that we can take an initiative. I think that's the best thing.
Well, I think the individuals living in the Western countries can play a very crucial role. Because if we see back in history, when the Africans were fighting for their self-determination, for their right of independence, they were ignored. Even Margaret Thatcher called Mr. Nelson Mandela a terrorist at that time. But the change came because the civil society, the Western country, especially in the UK, built up pressure and they pressurized their government, their democratic government. Eventually, the civil society compelled the UK government and other governments in the European continent to take notice of that problem and to condemn the apartheid brutalities back in Africa, South Africa. So in the same way, the civil society and the European countries, with the help of human rights organization and other organizations or NGOs, can make a difference. And it will be very important if we together also demand our politicians in these countries to take this new problem seriously. Then that will make a difference.
Yeah, a little
thing to add. I just want to thank you as the organizers, but also the audience. I think what you are doing here, listening and getting this new information, and we as sharing some of the information, is already so important, because the next time you hear something about it, or the next time you meet someone who says something about it, you can add or correct or add at least to the shared knowledge about this conflict. So I think it starts really with this, and then, you know, people hopefully are ready to take more action, more steps. Already this is so very important. Yeah, I'm very grateful that so many people are here to listen to something that's so, well, who knows about it? It's so forgotten, yeah.
Well, I have still so many questions, but since time is running tight, maybe do you have some questions to raise? Would you like to ask something in the last 10 minutes?
I think it's unfortunate that the Falago knew about criminal law had to leave so quickly.
Yeah.
Because I was wondering what he would have to say about what sorts of doors need to be knocked on next in order to get something moving with regard to the whole question of the criminal law aspects of this internationally. And it seems to me also that you have to start thinking about what light can be shined on this situation. And I think right away of an organization in the United States called Democracy Now!, which is a news source in the United States. This conflict reminds me very much of a report that I saw by Democracy Now! About West Sahara. The issues are very similar. A small country now being oppressed by Morocco because of the resources. And Democracy Now! Sent a team there, and the team did not have an easy time of it. But I think that Democracy Now!, the woman in charge of doing the actual reporting, her name is Amy Goodman, they did make a trip there. They did do their best to report on what was going on. And as much as possible, there needs to be light shown on this situation, wherever the light can come from. It doesn't really matter at this point. Even small sources of light are helpful, I think. One other fact that I think, I only heard this week that, this is with regard to CPAC. China apparently is building a port in Greece now. And they're trying in all different ways to get their products to Europe. And so this strategic aspect of they want a port in on your territory is part of the plan to get their products over to their port in Europe, in Greece. So it's kind of fits all together, actually.
And he talked of an organization here in the Netherlands that points out what is sort of the legal way to go for Syrian refugees. And he mentioned that this is somebody who's very grounded in these realities who might be able to help. So, but unfortunately she's not here, and I don't know anything more until I also have a chance maybe to meet her. But there are apparently ways people who know more about this. Yeah.
And there's one other thing that I'm interested in is that what companies are supplying arms to Pakistan, and what pressure can be put on those companies outside of Pakistan. There are all kinds of ways. I know that in the United States, the nuns, you know, the Catholic nuns, they go to the shareholders meetings of big companies, and they make they make trouble.
But I guess it cannot be hidden. When a state makes an agreement with another state, correspondents know how to find it. Like last year, there was elections in Sweden, and it was a huge campaign, anti-immigrant policy. The thing is, you can oppose the immigrants to come in our land, but you cannot oppose your country to sell your arms and ammunition to the regimes who are causing human crisis in the land, and people are running away. So Everybody knows all the Western countries are selling weapons to Pakistan. Every country wants to. Every country has its military trainers in Pakistan, providing trainings to them. But the problem is how to find it. I think it's not that much easy in today's world.
But yeah. America had a long-term military assistance deal.
Yeah,
right? So
America has, China has.
A lot has been written about it, but that would mean asking the US, for instance, or asking the US to ask its companies to no longer supply to Pakistan while they have this huge interest in fighting terrorism. So it's sort of, that's where your deadlock is.
But
then
it's important to realize that in the United States, there are many people who oppose the policy of the United States, and those are the people you need to activate.
Yes, of course.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
We have to work with those people who oppose, who knows Pakistan's real face. And we have to put pressure in every aspect of this, because the companies like Toyota and Ford is also providing Pakistan with vehicles, the military vehicles. And I think we can put pressure on these companies, as well as those governments who are directly involved in supporting Pakistan.
So you go lower in the
yeah,
tier.
From bottom up, we can put pressure on them.
Yeah.
And there's a campaign in the UK, I forgot the name, but there is a campaign in its name, and they are working in the UK, putting pressure on UK government not to support Pakistan, Saudi Arabia, and all those governments who are involved in human rights violations. So I think this is crucial. Those people who are in the US and do not agree with the US government of supporting countries like Pakistan and other rogue countries, I think it's a good opportunity for us to connect ourselves with those people and to put pressure on those countries who are supporting Pakistan. And
or maybe rather, if you put it like this, supporting rogue killings or something like, maybe they can support Pakistan if it behaves properly with its citizens.
Yeah, maybe.
Sorry, we just want to get to three questions before we finish the event, so is it okay?
Thank you, all of you, for being here, and thank you so much for Asia for organizing this event. My name is Abdul Razik, and I'm coming from Sudan. Sudan is, we also have a genocide, and I'm a genocide survivor as well. And the story of Balochistan is similar to the story of Sudan and to the stories of many different countries. If I come to human rights, we have human rights, but it doesn't mean to everyone, because we just have rights of genocide, whether you flee your country or you just die there. And those kind of stories are just going on, and the United States and the European Union are still giving money to the oppressed governments, so they will continue those kind of stuff. And they are not allowing for the NGOs to go there. So I just want to know why they are still doing this. Why they want some people die because of their interests.
I think we all agree with you. Yeah, that's the problem. We are facing the same problem. We have.
Yeah, my question is, Suzanna, she's a journalist and she has.
But can you repeat
the
question?
Yeah. My question is that why the United Nations and the European Union are still supporting the dictatorships or those who are still keeping genocide in their own countries?
But why they are still supporting Pakistan?
Yeah,
I mean,
he's from Sudan, and
and the same happened there.
Yeah, they're still supporting those who are killing people in their countries.
They're supporting the perpetrators of these wires.
You mean the UN is supporting the perpetrators? Are you saying that?
I mean, EU and the United Nations, they do support this kind of stuff.
They support these kind of states.
They support the dictatorships.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yes. That's a very good point, because I've also questions, for instance. Pakistan has, for instance, I'm making a concrete example, okay? Pakistan has this trade agreement with the European Union on which it can deliver certain goods on preferred tariffs. So it's called GSP Plus program, and that is conditional to Pakistan upholding human rights. And only now, after years of this program running, there are some reasons to doubt whether that program actually continues while, you know, human rights abuse is happening there. I think for diplomats, there is this sort of balance of keeping in touch with this country, not completely alienated. So you have some access over the rights, over the human rights abuses. So it's just this balance in which they, in which they are. And I've asked questions about this from the Dutch government, but also from American officials, and it always ends up with, you're right, but we want this access. Obviously, they would not say this on record, but and I think that's the conundrum which they find themselves in. And I guess from what you're saying, you would want them to sort of sever ties until they shape up or something, or. The question is, will they shape up if you sever ties? What really works in Pakistan now is there's this organization called FATF. It's an organization in Paris, and it monitors if countries do enough to eradicate extremism, terrorism. And Pakistan is now rounding up all these militants because they are they feel they might end up on the blacklist. When they are on the blacklist, nobody will bail them out anymore. The FATF is sort of an alarm bell. If it goes ringing, then all sorts of international organizations like IMF say, whoa, no, we're not going to do business with you. I think these kind of signals are maybe even more helpful than the UN at this point, because the UN is sort of has to act like a guest because it represents so many nations. So, yeah, but I do see your point.
I think in Balochistan they succeeded in doing one thing which benefited Pashtuns in their experience. In the beginning of 2000s, the military was gradually succeeded to alienate the people of Balochistan or their voice from the mainstream of the political intellectual debates inside Pakistan. Because Balochistan doesn't have any city, it has only Quetta as its capital. Rest of the cities cannot be called cities. They're just small towns. So they don't have any media or any intellectual elite or something. The benefits with the Pashtun resistance movement or Pashtun protection movement was they were having some cities. They were having a good population inside the big cities like Karachi, like Islamabad, like even Lahore. And even outside Pakistan, so they use it wisely. I appreciate whatever they did, and it's like inspiring thing to follow. But Balochistan was blocked before reaching to this level. Like when Sabine Mahmood tried to help in Karachi in T2F
with the conference on Balochistan,
she was shot killed within 20 minutes of it. Was such this kind of discussion, nothing else. But when she moved out, within 20 minutes, she was just killed. And the sympathizers outside Balochistan were afraid to join themselves with the voice of Balochistan. The Pashtun leadership, especially Manzoor Pashtun, did it very wisely, very carefully, and very good to connect his own intellectuals and then to the mainstream. And the main benefit was the cities. where there was at least a good population of Pashtun which could rise any time on their call. If Balochistan is locked for 3 years, 2 decades, no one minds it. Nothing is going out or nothing is going in Balochistan. There's nothing. It's just people dying. But if Pashtun are on the streets, they could block some cities.
Yeah, when we were on the street at that time, there was no social media, unfortunately. If we had a social media at that time, we would be spreading awareness about Balochistan. But when the social media came into being, we were already
outnumbered.
We were already
outnumbered. And they picked everybody who can speak. And they were not, the Baloch people of Balochistan was not able to reinforce the new people. So there, all the leadership was in the cage.
Secondly, we have our social media activists active in the Gulf states and not in Pakistan because it's not allowed. Anybody who says a single word in the social media, and he's living in Pakistan, so it's for sure that he's going to be killed. And Pakistan's so brutal in that regard. If Pakistan can kill a professor just for holding a conference in Karachi, then it can kill the state can kill anyone. But now there are people who are social media activists, and Pakistan has a policy against them. And recently, our friends received notices. Many of them were blocked by Twitter and Facebook. And recently, the Twitter did it in a larger scale. One of my friends, Kia, sitting here, he received a message from Twitter saying that you were violating Pakistani law because he shared a video Taj showed there, the army forces killing Baloch people. I mean, the Twitter thinks that this is, sharing this brutal video, this violence Pakistan is conducting in Balochistan is violating Pakistan law. This is hilarious. And we have this problem. I think we should also keep in mind that social media is also somehow being played by rogue states such as Pakistan.
I'm wondering also about the excess.
Excess, yeah. Too,
because like, I have some figures, 88% has a high degree of depravity in Balochistan against 51 in KP.
Yep.
63% lives below the poverty line. The question is, of course, how many people can you find that have a smartphone and,
sorry.
Yeah, I'm afraid.
We just have one last question because we're out of time, and then we'll finish up. Is that okay?
Okay.
Yeah. Mine is not necessarily a question. I'd like to come to like a wider conclusion, and I would like to ask your opinion about that. First, I would like to have a comment on the question of arms deals, as it was mentioned, that Western European companies and countries are having contracts with the military in Pakistan, right? So just imagine that we would be able to overcome the arm lobby, which I doubt, but just imagine we are able to do that. So Western countries are stopped dealing arms with Pakistan, for example. I assume that China would be quite happy to take these the places of these companies in the arms deal. So in that sense, unfortunately, I don't see that putting, for example, pressure on the weapon industry in West would actually help the situation. It would even like strengthen the status quo because the Western influence would be even smaller in Pakistan. That's one thing. The other thing is that as far as I observed, the possible solutions for the problem and issue of Balochistan is that mostly international organizations and international or global organizations would be able to put pressure on the Pakistan and the central government and to move this issue forward. But for me, it really seems to be, for example, that the International Court of Justice, the participation is voluntary, which is like, well, what's the point of the organization then if it's voluntary? Obviously, those countries which are like oppressing people as Pakistan, for example, they're not going to join these organizations. The other question is, for example, the United Nations. And I think that we are like having a global order with global problems, problems such as the issue in Balochistan, as it was mentioned in Sudan, and the international organization seems to have the lack of the ability, the capacity to pressure. And I see the problem as that we are having a global order where the pressure or the well, core terms, we are still thinking in like nation states, and obviously international organizations such as the United Nations and whatsoever are not going to be efficient until nation states are not willing to give up a huge part of their sovereignty to these global organizations in order to be efficient at putting pressure in these countries. And my question would be, whether do you agree with this, not agree, what do you think about it?
Yeah, I one thing about what you said about China, like if Western companies would stop their arms sales to Pakistan, it would affect Pakistan. Of course they would go to their all-weather friends, as they call China, but they do realize that the material they get from there is not the material they get from other states.
Yeah.
So they would they would be harmed by that, even though publicly they would probably deny it. So it would send a signal. I mean, it wouldn't stop them from doing the human rights abuses for sure. They would still have other options with China, but I think it still could be a very good signal.
Yeah, actually, we are living in a free society here in Europe, and this is the most civilized form of human history. I think this is morally incorrect if you think if you don't provide Pakistan with weapons, it will get from somewhere else. But your weapon is killing us, and that is morally incorrect, and I have the right to raise question, and I have the right to question your morality. I think this the morality thing is very important in this regard. You cannot deny that one. And secondly, as I joked about it, Chinese weapons are, I think, less harmful than the Western weapons. Maybe, because the Chinese, if the Pakistan gets support from Chinese and denied support from the Western countries, then it will be symbolic, and Pakistan will not go to that extent killing minorities, killing ethnic groups like Baloch people. I think that will make a big difference.
And a public acknowledgement itself makes the difference. When any Western country announces that I am not going to supply arms and ammunition to Pakistan military because it's committing human rights violations, it itself affects my defense. And another thing is, if I find a child on the road who is almost dying, I cannot kill the child because I think if I will not do, hunger will kill it. I don't have the right to kill someone because somebody has to kill it. At least I can take my hands off it. I'm not in this.
Sorry, just let me comment on this very quickly, because maybe I was misunderstood. I'm not agreeing with the West arms to Pakistan. I'm just saying that I'm not sure if that would be a good solution. Morally, of course, it's like, no, okay, I'm not.
The solutions that the profession mentioned, that one solution, if somebody's on another territory than Pakistan, that's a great solution, but you have to be reasonably identify that as a perpetrator, and there again you have a huge difficulty because they're not so easily identified because it's hidden. So yeah, I mean, some realism is not so bad.
Yeah,
it gives a shock.
Can we give a round of applause to the speakers? And thank you all for coming. I hope you can take something away from this, and I hope that you'll talk to your friends, you'll talk to your family, you'll talk to your teachers, like people you meet on the street, and like we really want to raise as much awareness as possible and resolve the conflict. So thank you for coming.
Yeah. And also, if you have any questions, you can chat to us.
Yeah.